My name is Bill Ross. I'm chairman of RADIOFEST this year. I'd like to welcome everybody here today to make our first presentation at RADIOFEST 91. We are very pleased to welcome Ed Dervishian, who taught television at the American Television Institute for 8 years, and who served as Dr. Lee DeForest's personal assistant for 2 of those years. Ed is a native Californian who didn't heed the advice of Horace Greeley and came east instead of staying west. Ed has just spent his whole life in electronics, with a heavy emphasis on television and microwaves. Ed is a ham, W9VSU, lives in Lincolnwood, Illinois, and has been a continuous member of the ARRL for 58 years. Ed is retired from Motorola, is a life member of the IEEE, was the youngest member of the DeForest Pioneers, and is a life member of the prestigious Radio Club of America. Ed, you are very kind to have joined us today. We look forward to your presentation. Ed Dervishian.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for those kind words. Welcome, folks, and let me say it's a pleasure indeed. In spite of those fine choice words that he gave you, I want you to know that I'm not an inventor, I'm not among who's who, but I'm in the top 10 of who's he. One of my profs at Northwestern had commented every time the class in public speaking came about that the three most important criteria of good speech making is to have a good opening, a good close, and whatever is in between to be short, sweet, and to the point. Well, you've heard my opening. Let's see how well I do on the other facets of my little talk. I want you to know that I feel that I am one of the luckiest and richest people in the world. I said that to my friends and colleagues at Motorola when I retired just short of 5 years ago. I told them that I was the richest, first of all, to have all these people come to see me and to greet me, but more importantly, I hadn't lost a single day of work for illness, not one in over 20 years. I have all my teeth and most of my hair, and I didn't owe anybody a dime. That I think I'll take my profit-sharing money, go down to Central America, and buy a small country. That broke them up. I want you also to know that I am the world's greatest procrastinator. The world's greatest. It was just 2 years ago that I was visiting the DeForest Museum out in California, and the curator, Jim Weldon by name, asked me if I might record some of my experiences with Lee DeForest so that they could have them as a collection. It's been 2 years, and we're going to complete that assignment today with my camera equipment that I brought. Hopefully it turns out as good as I expect it to be. I'd like to begin my association or thoughts about Lee DeForest with the time when I was a Boy Scout in California, and the man that was teaching us the code was himself a radio enthusiast living in Long Island, New York. His name was Ed Cornell Sr. His son, Ed Jr., and I got our ham licenses together, and I was fortunate to see him just last week up at the Oshkosh airfare. Ed Cornell Sr. was a radio enthusiast at the turn of the century. And what was radio at the turn of the century? Nothing but dots and dashes. I couldn't relate that period of time. I couldn't project myself backwards from the late 20s to the turn of the century. But he was experiencing some odd things. In fact, as he listened to his earphones one night, he heard this voice for the first time saying, "This is Lee DeForest. Anyone hearing my voice, please telephone me at Murray Hill 8, whatever the number was." And this man was so scared, he said he didn't tell anybody about it for 2 weeks. I couldn't project myself backwards to that period. After all, we have a radio. It talks. It has music. It has all of the things that we need. And I couldn't project myself backwards, nor could I ever dream that I would ever meet Lee DeForest, much less be fortunate enough to become his personal assistant. I met DeForest for the first time in 1940 here in the Chicago area. In fact, he was the director of research for various projects, and I was first a student and then an instructor, something I never dreamed would last 8 years. But during my first visit with him, I related that story of this man hearing his voice and being so scared that he didn't tell anybody for 2 weeks. And Lee DeForest said to me, "He was scared?" I said, "Doctor, he was so scared he didn't tell anybody for 2 weeks." He said, "Well, that's incredible. That's incredible." So I want you to remember that story for a moment, because I'm going to bring that up again a little later, and what happened to that story. Well, during the period of time I was with him, I got to know him a little better each time we bumped into each other. And at a time when Lee DeForest was busy with all kinds of projects, he had a small company in Mexico that made radios and shortwave sets. He was busy at American Television as a director of research in devising new devices, and his mind was very active all the time. And somehow, we just bumped into each other now and then. Not long after that acquaintance, Lee DeForest and I were having lunch together near the school, and my wife, who worked nearby, had joined us. If you can picture now, this is during World War II. And Lee DeForest turned to me and said, "Ed, what are you doing these days? I don't see you around the school much." I said, "Well, doctor, I'm an inspector for the U.S. Navy out at Western Electric on the radar program." "Yeah? What do you do in the daytime?" I said, "That's what I do in the daytime." "Well, you mean you're not teaching at night?" "Teaching?" I said, "Well, I'm teaching at nights." "Radar," he says. "What frequency is that?" I said, "Hold it, can't tell you." What power is it?" "Can't tell you that." And he's getting exasperated. He tries to get around it by some other question. I said, "Doctor, that's the same question. I cannot tell you. You have no need to know, and that's classified information." He's getting exasperated that here's a man that he knows reasonably good personally. He runs into him almost every day, but he won't tell him anything about radar. When he realized he isn't going to learn anything about radar from me, after all, I'm under oath to do this in this classified way, he says, "Well, Ed, what do you think they'll use radar for when the war is over?" "Well, doctor, when the war is over, they'll have them on ships to guide them across the ocean to keep them from bumping into icebergs and other ships. They'll have them on the ground to bring airplanes through the clouds. They'll have them on shores to bring ships in and out of harbors," and just general stuff he could have read in any newspaper. Well, lo and behold, that afternoon, Lee DeForest called a press conference with the Chicago Tribune. And it was Larry Walters, who might still be around, if some of you have been with the Tribune. He called a press conference with the Chicago Tribune and related to him all of the things that he thought would be the future of radar. The next morning, I'm reading this at the breakfast table at the with my wife, and I said, "Hey, Marge, get a load of this. Look at this." And she read a couple of the paragraphs of that, and she says, "Well, those are the things you told him yesterday." I said, "That's right, but remember, that's Lee DeForest saying it. If it was Ed Dervishian, they wouldn't even put that in the back page." Well, I've kept that paper, and I thought it was very humorous because his name was so prominent and worth so much more than a flunky like Ed Dervishian. Well, lo and behold, he asked me to join him as his assistant in building some of these devices, among them a portable diathermy machine, which he later sold to the Mayo Clinic, mechanical color television equipment and various other projects. But among those periods, there were occasions where we clashed on things that I didn't necessarily agree with. And I learned that he was a diehard. There were lots of occasions where if he didn't see it or hadn't heard of it, it almost didn't exist. But you had to prove it to him. I remember one occasion, we were driving downtown for something. I was driving, we're going over the Outer Drive area, and this was 1946. I remember it distinctly because I bought one of the first new cars that came after the war ended. He looked at this car in front of us and he says, "Hey, look at that car in front of us. It's got a windshield wiper on the back window." I said, "So what?" He says, "There you go. Every time I say something or see something, you say you've seen it before." Doctor, that is a standard accessory with Olds, Pontiac, and Cadillac, and Chevrolet. And you can get that easy. He thought about it for a minute, and he said, "Tell you what I'll do, Ed. I'll give you 50 cents for every one of those you can show me between now and the time we get downtown." Okay. We're driving along, and here's one in front of us. There's no point in looking at that same one, so I'm looking at the cars that are going the other way. I said, "There goes one." And he says, "I didn't see it." Oh, we're going to play that game. Well, I learned to know how to handle him. So instead of continuing down the Outer Drive and seeing the same car, I thought, we're not going to do that. I turned off and went down LaSalle Street, where there's lots of cars parallel to the curb all the way down. We went down LaSalle Street, and I stopped the car. He says, "What are we stopping here for?" I said, "You see that one, and you see that one, two riding together." And further down, by the time we got to Madison Avenue, he says, "Don't count anymore, Ed, don't count anymore. I see them." We counted 12. Another occasion, he wanted something built, and he's suggesting which tube we use. Well, he names the tube, and I said, "Well, you don't want to use that old tube, doctor." He says, "Well, what's the matter with it?" I said, "Well, that tube was fine in its day, but today we got this tube, and that tube that'll do that job better." He says, "I never heard of those tubes." I thought, gee, the flunky is telling the inventor of the radio tube that his idea stinks. How do you do that? It took me 3 days to get up enough nerve. As we went to lunch almost every day, I realized what was wrong. And I had to be diplomatic as I could be. And remember, I'm the flunky. And I'm considerably younger than he at the time. And I gingerly approached the subject again. I said, "Doctor, I think I've realized something I don't believe you have." "Yeah, what's that, Ed?" "Doctor, I don't believe you've realized that since your day of the invention of the vacuum tube, that so much has been done, so many people working on various devices, that it's not possible for one man just to read the accomplishments of others. As a result, I read everything I can about tubes, their power output, their frequency response, their amplification factor, anything I can about tubes. I happen to know that that tube that I mentioned will do your job better than the tubes that you're talking about." He kept eating his soup. I thought, gee, what did I do now? Insult this man? Well, 3 days went by, and again at lunchtime, Lee DeFore says, "Ed, you know the other day you were telling me how much electronics has grown?" "You're absolutely right." Because I told him at the time that you read the things that interest you, I read the things that interest me, and a third guy is reading things you and I know nothing about, but it's electronics. That's the message I wanted to get across, and he realized that. And 3 days later, he says, "You know, you're absolutely right." That made me feel 10 feet tall, that he thought about that and was polite enough to tell me, rather than just agree on the day I told him. Another incident. He was periodically going to his home in California, and at times, in a roundabout way, he'd go to Mexico to see how his company was doing. And on one of those occasions, he said, Ed, I'm going to Mexico on Sunday, and while I'm gone, I want you to do this and this and this, and just keep doing those, whatever it was we were working on. Okay. I proceeded to do those things, and after he was gone, I read in the local papers that Lee DeForest is going to be the guest star on the Campbell Soup program in Hollywood with the then living Dick Powell. I thought, how can he do that? He told me he was going to go to Mexico on Sunday. Well, I must realize the paper must be right. So I had made a disc recorder. This is before there was any tape, before there was any wire recorder, and you can realize that the only way you could capture sound in those days was on a record or on sound on film. Well, I couldn't afford any sound on film, so I had made a disc recorder. And when Lee DeForest's part came on that radio, he was doing the reenactment of that first voice broadcast that I mentioned earlier. So I recorded that first voice broadcast of Lee DeForest. I still have that record today. And what is he doing? He's reenacting this for the whole country to see. Well, when he returned, I said, Doctor, you said you were going to Mexico on Sunday. Yeah, what about it? I said, I got proof that says you didn't go. He looked at me indignantly and he said, what kind of proof you got? I said, you were on the Campbell Soup program with Dick Powell. Yes. I said, and that was Sunday, and I made a record of it. He turned around and he said to me, let me tell you something, Ed. Marie and I went right from the NBC studios direct to the Los Angeles airport, and we flew to Mexico, and that was Sunday. As far as the record, I'd like to hear it. The station didn't record it. Flattened me right to the ground. Well, there were occasions like that, many of them humorous, and some of them downright challenging to me. And I must say, he was a diehard. He had to be shown, but after a while, he believed it, and believed it genuinely, and really smiled to tell you about it. During the time we had made this mechanical color television thing, it was more than a whim on his part. When he told me what he was doing, making this color television thing, mechanical color, which was a strip of clear plastic running in front of the picture tube with color stripes on it, and a similar strip in front of the camera tube. And if you synchronize those two, you got a semblance of color. Believe me, your imagination had to run wild to see anything that you liked. But when I asked him, why are you doing this? Why do you have to build this to get a patent on it? And he said, the patent office said it won't work. And I almost said, I agree with him. But I bit my tongue the few times. And lo and behold, the patent office must have gotten wind that we're doing this. Probably didn't want to be embarrassed that they refused the patent when here's the man that's got the thing working. So the patent was granted even before we turned it on for the first time. Not long after that, I was visiting the IRE show in New York, and CBS was showing their color, which was similar, but better pictures. And I looked at this thing, and I said to the young chap that was there, you got a beautiful color picture here, but you'll never get a patent on that. And he said, why not? I said, if you look up Lee DeForest patent number so-and-so and so-and-so, it covers everything you're showing. They never showed it again. And I asked Lee DeForest at the time, and that's what prompted him to tell me this, said, you know, I think we're wasting our time, doctor. Why do you say that, Ed? Well, I think somebody's going to invent this in an electronic system. He says, well, that may be true, but I got to prove to the patent office they're wrong. And he took lots of exceptions to people that might have thought differently. Believe me, his mind was working all the time. There were occasions where we visited back and forth between his residence here in Chicago he'd come over to my place, and periodically when his wife and my wife were talking, she would be overhearing Lee DeForest explaining something to me. And periodically she'd turn around and say, "Lee, why are you worried about that? You got enough money." "Well, I want to do this." And very active person. And he couldn't let go of things. At one time, when the GCA aircraft system was being pushed through major airports in the country, I had an idea of a system that's still viable, incidentally, where you don't have to talk to the ground at all, and with ground microwave systems with two antennas from each end of every runway, the airplane can see those radar signals, radar if you will, it's really microwave, and bring the plane in right down to the touchdown point without talking to anybody on the ground, which is important and must be done with GCA. I wanted Lee DeForest to be jointly associated with me in that, and because it would be easier for a patent to come through with his name on it. They never heard of Ed Dervishian, but Lee DeForest might work. Incidentally, I'm working actively on a postage stamp in his honor, and with some of your help and support, maybe we can push this through. The picture that I've selected is the front jacket cover of his autobiography, which I've reproduced, and I think it's an excellent one. As most of you collectors know and appreciate, Lee DeForest has done an awful lot for so many of us. In fact, I think the entire world. Without him, there wouldn't be voice or music on radio, there wouldn't be sound on film, motion pictures, and maybe three or four of the patents that of his 307 are worth talking about. But they've revolutionized our way of living, our way of communication. Well, continuing, Lee DeForest had ideas that never quit, and he was active throughout his entire life and continued that way until his passing. Do any of you have any questions that you might want to interject before you forget it? There must be something. You have a question.
When you have a moment, can you explain what the three most important patents were?
Oh, surely. Good questions. Well, the three most important ones, of course, are the three-element vacuum tube. That came, you might say, that changed the concept of radio as we know it. He was the first man in the world to put a voice on radio waves, the first. And of course, he's invented sound on film motion pictures. There's three of them. For the vacuum tube, as an amplifier for the hard of hearing, he received $50,000 from Western Electric. $50,000 for strictly the hard of hearing. A few years later, he got another $90,000 for additional claims of that tube for a radio transmitter, an oscillator, or other RF uses. $90,000 more. And I'm sure your arithmetic could easily calculate that his total income for the invention of the vacuum tube was $140,000. If you relate those $140,000 to the number of tubes that were made, the number of radios that were reproduced, the number of transmitters that went into use, and all the other uses that that tube created, if they paid him $140 million, it was cheap. But he got $140,000 for that, which may have been big money. His hand was up for it.
You mentioned the first voice transmitter. Wasn't that the first electronic voice? But Edison had the first voice by using spark transmitter.
Edison did what?
Edison. Edison, I believe his name.
Fessenden,
yeah. He had the first voice transmitter, but we used spark transmitter. I guess before she used electronic, but that would probably be different with it.
I don't know how to answer that, except that the man who taught me the code was one of the first that ever heard a voice whether any voices were heard on radio before that or not, I wasn't around. This was shortly after the turn of the century. I don't know the precise year, and I'm not even sure that his son, that personal friend that I met a week ago, I don't think he knew what year that was that his father heard that voice. But there's lots of controversies in any inventor's life. I knew that Lee DeForest was constantly in court with other inventors. There's no secret about that. And some words that were exchanged that were less than pleasant. I'll clean up one of them for you. One night, I heard a speech by Edwin Armstrong at Northwestern University. And unknown to me, these two guys were suing each other in court regularly. Anyway, the next morning, I went back to the television school, and I said to Lee DeForest, I said, I heard a friend of yours on in a lecture last night. Yeah, who was that? I said, Armstrong. Well, that's... I'll leave that word out. He said, I had to sue him to prove that I was right in court. Well, gee, and I thought, gee, and I told Armstrong that I worked with a friend of his, Lee DeForest. I got no response from that end of it, and I was surprised. Well, it's easy for people to invent something that's close enough to somebody else's patent and have friction one way or the other. And fortunately, I never got involved with any of that. There's another question over here.
Mr. DeForest lived till what year again?
He lived till 1961. Just happened to have a picture of his gravestone right here.
Where's he buried at?
He's buried in an Indian cemetery in Southern California.
Do you happen to know how he reacted to some of the new innovations like transistors?
Yes, and, yes. The transistor came about when he was still alive, and I'm sure he didn't take too kindly to it because it reduced the value and thought of using vacuum tubes. And even his wife Marie said, I don't want a transistor television in my apartment. No, none of those things. It's probably no different than some people who would never own an automobile when the horseless carriage was being phased out. Project that even further when, sure, another generation thought nothing of driving and owning cars, but they wouldn't fly an airplane. And who knows what the next mode of transportation might be that you and I might not want to do that because we're stuck with our ways. That's human nature. But I visited their home on several occasions. They were very receptive to my young children at the time, and we have some wonderful color movies that we made in his home. On one occasion, I went out there to specifically make a copy of the audio of his program when he was on the show called This Is Your Life. Some of you may remember that with Ralph Edwards. They made a beautiful film of that, and I wanted this copy of the soundtrack. So on two occasions, I went out there with audio recorder from home, and the first time, he didn't have the film. The second time, he says, well, I got the film now. Okay, so I went out again. This time in the basement of his house, we set up the projector and got the recorder all hooked up, and I take out the reel of film and I'm running to see which is front and back, and I looked at this thing and I said, Doc, there's a couple of lovers on here and you're not one of them. This is not your life. He says, let me see that. I showed him the film. He says, oh my goodness, my friend has been hounding me. He's given me the wrong film, and this is what he's looking for. So we didn't record the soundtrack. Well, we left it for another day. And another day happens to be this time in New York City during the annual meeting of the DeForest Pioneers. Well, on that occasion, I happened to be in Connecticut on a job with Motorola, and I realized that that's the night of the DeForest Pioneers meeting in downtown New York. I think I can just make it if I jump on a fast train and get down there. So I hopped the train, got down to the railroad station, and had a lot of equipment with me. I talked the red cap into hauling all my stuff across the street to the Statler Hotel, paid him a few bucks, and got a room, went up, changed clothes, ran right down and hopped the subway, and I'm at the meeting just about the time dinner is halfway through. So I motioned the waiter to come over and just bring me anything you got. I don't care what it is, just bring it. And I could see the MC, Fred M. Link, looking over at me to see, who is that guy that crashed the party? I went up and I gave him my card and told him, I'm number 138, here's my name, blah, blah, blah. And he introduced me as their honored guest because I came from Chicago while the rest of them were from the area. But it turned out real good, and I had brought my tape recorder and I recorded the soundtrack of that program, and I've accidentally erased it since then, but fortunately I made copies to send to other people, so I've gotten it back that way. At least, think of it. Your question.
Yes, about 1951, DeForest wrote an article for, I think, Radio News Magazine, where he discussed the mechanical color system, and he was actually pushing the electronic system at the time. But he said that he was working on a system where the disc, the color wheel, moved in an orbital fashion. I don't believe it's the one you described earlier.
No, it was not an orbital fashion. The system...
It's at a one-inch diameter orbit, where the color filters, instead of rotating, orbited in front of the cathode ray tube.
How did he synchronize that with the receiving tube?
He said nothing else about it, other than this was something that he was... it suggested like he had some people doing research for him, and this was the thing they were interested in. This is based on, what I'm saying is based on an article from, I think, Radio News, about 1951.
I have an issue of Radio Craft magazine with his picture on the front and with his autograph and asking me someday to collaborate with him. And in that issue, there are many contributions with pictures of famous electronic and radio scientists, engineers, inventors, all of whom have praised Lee DeForest for his many accomplishments and contributions to the art of electronics and radio. And I hope to use that as part of the material to prove to the U.S. Postal Department that certainly this man deserves a postage stamp. Heaven knows, the Post Office Department...
gets one, as far as I get.
Yes. You know, as we all know, the Post Office Department has printed stamps of horses, dogs, cats, flower pots, trees, fish, and yeah. There's all kinds of postage stamps that are worthless, and if some of you are old enough to remember that Jim Farley, Postmaster General during Roosevelt's era, recognized that FDR was an ardent stamp collector. So Jim Farley literally invented new stamps regularly to please FDR. And he must have done a pretty good job, because much of that criteria and that theory has rubbed off on all of the postmaster generals that have followed since then. They realize that enough of us knuckleheads that collect stamps are willing to pay untold dollars to buy a whole page of them and stash them away that puts money in their pockets. I've told my children that stamps are worth more than money. The value of money is constantly falling, while the stamp never falls. If anything, it goes up. If you can hang on to them, as I've done for all these years, keep doing it. Well, I'm still looking forward to hopefully living long enough to see the before a stamp. Your question.
Yeah. I have in my collection a letter from Lee DeForest to Chicago, from his California home to a Chicago autograph collector, saying thank you for, and here's my autograph. Just thank you for inviting me to see your collection, but I have no plans to be in Chicago. I have no plans for visiting or being in Chicago. So it's 1939, and so I'm curious, what brought DeForest to Chicago, and was there a connection to Sanabria?
That's a very good point, and I'll give you my personal opinion. In spite of the three fortunes that Lee DeForest had amassed in his lifetime, one of which was over $1 million, in my opinion, he was one of the poorest financial analysts and managers of money anybody could bump into. So Lee DeForest lost more than $1 million during the crash of 29. I don't know what stocks he owned, but he was never known to be a good manager of money. And so many people took advantage of his name, his reputation, and I don't doubt for a minute that Sanabria could have been one of those. He gave DeForest a job, salary, and at the time when Lee DeForest wasn't earning any money, that was the best thing in the world that could happen to him at that period. In fact, his presence in Chicago in 1940, he was here in the Chicago area to head up a television class for supposedly a one-month period to teach some of us. It was an advanced class in television. I had been in Chicago the year before that for a short period and built a television transmitter and a receiver, wired equipment, if you will. It was not a live picture. It was a monoscope in a tube. It was a picture of Joan Blondell built into a vacuum device which was scanned with the same sweep circuits that scanned the cathode ray tube, and you saw that picture on the 7-inch screen. Well, because of that experience in building some television stuff, and knowing that there's much more to be had to learn, I came back to Chicago thinking I was going to stay 1 year. Would you believe in April of this year, it was 51 years, which proves I must be a hell of a slow learner. Anyway, as I said, I've been in this television business ever since then. But during that period, I got another important story to tell you that I've almost forgotten. During the war period, when he, DeForest, was trying to learn anything he could about radar and microwave, it was just not possible for getting him into the Western Electric Company to show him radar. Just no way. But after my stint with Lee DeForest, I had realized that by now, 1948, a lot of television stations are popping up all over, and I was ready to go back to my home in California to see what television would offer. But just before I left, a microwave company in the Chicago area, the president of which lived in the same apartment building that I lived in, invited me to come and visit their facility. It was NRK Manufacturing and Engineering Company. They built all kinds of microwave assemblies and radar components, and they were having trouble with their engineer, and the troubles they had were so severe, and the job was so unique, They didn't even know how to interview a prospective replacement. Think about that for a minute. How could you run a company and not know how to interview somebody that you want to replace? Well, my next door neighbor was a senior vice president of the bank that owned that company. And the company was president lived in the same apartment building. So he invited that man to come down to see me. And he came into the apartment on Sunday with his slippers, and he looked around my apartment and he says, "You live here?" "Yeah, I live here. Why?" He says, "It looks more like a lab than a residence." And my wife laughed. You know, I got television in one corner, ham radio in another, microwave junk and audio recorders, and the living room looked like a lab. And my wife still laughs at that. Well, anyway, they offered me this job, and I'll even cut that story a lot shorter. I went out to California and had a couple of nice interviews, but none of the stations had any equipment yet. So I accepted this job in Chicago, thinking I'm only going to stay 6 months. Well, I stayed there 11 years. And during that period, I finally got Lee DeForest over there to see microwave for the first time. And if any of you have seen X-band microwave stuff, you know that it's rectangular pipe and plumbing. Lee DeForest had never seen any of this before, never. And he looked at this test bench and he says, "What frequency is this?" I said, 3 centimeters. "Well, how do you know?" I said, "Well, I read that right here on this freak meter." "What is the frequency meter?" "A metallic cylinder about this big with a micrometer head on it." I said, "I read that right here on this freak meter." He says, "I don't believe that. You ought to be able to prove it another way." "Well, doctor, you got to believe something. After all, this was calibrated for us by Bell Lab." "You ought to be able to prove it another way, Ed." I'm thinking, well, what am I going to do with this? So, I said, "All right, doctor. Our signal source right here is the klystron." "The what?" I said, "The klystron. That's the successor to your vacuum tube." "Never heard of the klystron, I guess." "That's generating 3 centimeter microwave signals. We are modulating that with this 1,000 cycle square wave. So coming down this pipe is 3 centimeters with 1,000 cycle tone riding on that. Now this first device is a variable attenuator." "That's a volume control to you, doctor." "And the second thing is this frequency meter. When you tune it to resonance, it robs power out of this line and you see a dip in this SWR meter. And of course, this next thing is a slotted line, which is reading the hills and valleys of this RF that's there. Now, as you know, doctor, the distance between a peak and a valley is a quarter wavelength. You know that, regardless of what the frequency." "Yeah." "Now, doctor, instead of moving this slotted line back and forth to read the peaks and the valley, let's take this piece of tin and reflect that right back into this open waveguide. And the distance I move that to create min and max on that meter is a quarter wavelength, right?" So he's looking over my shoulder as I move this piece of tin against the open slotted line. As I moved it ever so small, the meter flopped from one extreme to the other, and he looked at this in utter amazement and said, "Where did you learn that, Ed?" I said, "Doctor, that's as old as you are." "Why?" "Why? I've never seen that before." I said, "Doctor, the reason you never saw this before, you've been working with long waves all your life, real long, and it's not practical to walk down the street with a great big sheet of tin in your hand against the signal to see a meter move." And I thought to myself, my, if this man is impressed with that, think of all the kids in school that don't believe the book either. So by that time, DeVry Technical Institute had become a bigger school than American Television, where I was, and I called my longtime IRE buddy, Joe Gershon. "Hey, Joe, I got a phenomenon I want to show you and your staff when you got time." I packed up all this gear in a portable form, took it over at the school, and ran through some of the similar things that I had shown DeForest with a few more, using some horns, using variable attenuators, and metal to bounce the signals, and went through several hours of experiments with he and his staff. Well, all of this was surplus electronic junk. And he was so impressed with that, he said, "Ed, make us three sets of gear just like that." Well, believe it or not, the school changed their curriculum. They taught microwave first before they got into lower frequencies, because these fine or small wavelengths made it possible to see and do things that you couldn't do with long waves, and the principles were practically the same, except that they followed line of sight rather than the curvature of the earth. That's a basic difference. And of course, feeble power could be amplified with dishes and horns and made all the difference in the world. So in a sense, that's my contribution to the teaching business. I have since made three of those things, making sure that one of them is always going to work when I put on free lectures to schools, ham clubs particularly. And believe me, there's things in there that most people, some even older than I, had never seen before. When I say older than I'll be 75 in a couple of weeks, and it'll be 5 years that I've retired from Motorola. And I want to get into some of the things that I've done, which I call fun during my job. You had a question, sir.
Yes.
Me? Yes.
Did you ever get your ham license?
I have my ham license continuously since 1932.
What was your first transmitter?
My first transmitter was a single 45 in a TNT circuit. I'd never have guts enough to turn that thing on again today. That was my first call was W6GXL. And believe me, I tell people today that when I got started in electronics, radios plugged in and toothbrushes didn't. And I'm sure many of you have gone through these things. I see a few faces that are probably as old as mine, but as a ham, I can honestly say that shortly after I got my ham license, boy, I thought I knew it all. And after about 10 years, I realized how much I had learned in 10 years. My God, there must be a lot I don't know. After the second 10 years went by, 20, holy smoke, how dummy I was back there 10 and 20 years ago. There must be still a lot I don't know. Well, it's now 58 years, and I still say I am a flunky compared to some of the things that people do today. But remember, the technology has changed and changed and changed. There are people that got into electronics long after the tube was dead, and they know nothing about tubes. They know a lot about transistors, and some that knew a lot about transistors in their early days probably got out of the electronics business about the time integrated circuits were coming in. Today, if you told somebody you're going to build something using discrete transistors and capacitors and resistors, he'd look at you, "Where have you been? My God, you can do that with this little chip, and that whole chip is the FM radio in this whole thing." Well, you know, there's chips that do lots of jobs, and nobody knows that better than the computer industry. You know, there's so many doing exactly that, working on new chips that are exotic in their nature and God knows how many layers, and they're simplifying the job significantly. During the time that I was with Motorola, I used to tell everybody, I got the most fun job in the company. I never called it work. I used to be loaned to the international division, and they sent me all over the country, all over the world, and I had the pleasure of doing this television system for Anwar Sadat's house, the King's Palace in Morocco, the airport in Tehran, the airport in Rio, the shipyard in Tel Aviv, every one of the Ford assembly plants in the United States, every Caterpillar facility, the Golden Gate Bridge, the Holland Tunnel, the Sears Tower, and it was fun. I didn't have to sell anything. I just designed the system, and somebody else put it together and made it fly. Somebody else had a question. Yours.
Some question about when did DeForest come to Chicago. As you probably realize, he was a physics professor at Lewis Institute.
Yes.
Back in probably the early 20s, or some thereabouts. My first visit with him was in 1931, when he visited Chicago, the WMAQ television studio, mechanical television studio, up on top of the Daily News building.
Incidentally, the man that's speaking is Mr. Parker, well known in the television and radio industry in this and other areas. Go ahead, sir.
Well, so even though he was in New York some of the time, the West Coast some of the time, he did have a home in Chicago.
Yes, yes, he did. Were there any other questions? I didn't want to. Yours, sir.
I was just wondering, sir, we were talking about his patent with the color television. He had quite a go around with Bird, didn't he? With the mechanical television.
I don't know that he had a suit pending. He may have had discussions, arguments, in fact. One of the things that came to light that borders on what you're saying, on one occasion I visited a museum in London, and in that museum were lots of equipments and particularly letters exchanged between Lee DeForest and Marconi.
Yeah.
If you recall, I didn't see any letters from Bird or regarding Bird, but after all, the scanning disc, which was Nipkow's invention, perfected by who knows how many people, the discussions and litigation between Lee DeForest and Marconi were probably the most prominent. In these letters that I read thoroughly through windows, there were not such that I could photograph, Lee DeForest was selling radio equipment for shipboard use, and so was Marconi. Marconi's theory was, of course, selling high power transmitters, 10,000 watts, 5,000 watts, for shipboard use. Lee DeForest was pushing his radios with tube type detectors, which made the sensitivity so much greater that he could communicate much further with his radios at 1/4 the power. Truly, they were true. But as I read Marconi's statements, the final one was really the crowning glory, which is, to me, good advertising. We don't care what you do, what you sell. We're selling transmitters with high power, and that's what the people want. So, you know, he might have had the best mousetrap, but if he didn't advertise it properly, who knows what his capabilities are.
Are these letters out of the Jim Weldon DeForest Museum there? Or?
No, those were in the museum in London.
Oh, okay.
The museum in California,
that is in
Foothill College, which is just south of Palo Alto.
Okay.
Foothill College, and it has all of his archives and his materials, some of the stuff I've donated and still have some more to send them, and I trust that Jim Weldon and the Motorola Museum will be able to show this tape if it's successful, and my engineer back there will tell me if he's hearing it properly. And we have one more question over here that I've...
When did American television end and DeForest training take over, or was there a connection between the two?
DeForest training was a different school. DeForest training was founded by a man named DeVry. And they used his name, with his permission, of course, to approve the lessons that DeForest Training were submitting to their students. And after a while, they quit sending him material to approve. And after a continuous period, quit sending him money too. So he tried to shut off the use of his name. But the courts decreed that if you let him use your name free and was founded on your name at the time it started, you have no right to shut off their business now. You should have done something about that. So the name DeForest Training continued until he, DeVry, decided to use his own name instead of DeForest Training. So it became DeVry School of Electronics and Engineering, which it still is, but now under the ownership of the WGN or Chicago Tribune, if you will. You have a question.
Yes, before DeForest invented the vacuum tube, wasn't he in Chicago when he found that a gas flame was electrically influenced, and some of that electrical influence on a gas flame led to this invention of the triode?
It could be. That was somewhat before my time, and I have not read those things accurately enough and recently enough to really verify that. Any other questions? Yours, sir.
What was the connection between American Television and DeForest?
What was the connection?
Yeah.
The connection was that Lee DeForest was the director of research at American Television, hired by the company, and as you know, the major stockholder and founder was U.A. Sanabria, the inventor of the interlace scanning system we use today. Your question.
Was DeForest still with Sanabria when DeForest Sanabria television sets were being made?
Yes, he was with him when that DeForest Sanabria television set was produced. There's a lot of those in use in the Chicago area particularly. Your question.
When did DeForest Sanabria or that company go out of business?
Why? Or I don't know the precise date, but the last things that the Sanabria or American Television Corporation made were, besides cathode ray tubes, incidentally they used to ship 600 5-inch cathode ray tubes every day. They later got into hydrogen thyrotrons in a period shortly after World War II, and the school business began to go downhill while other businesses took over, and I don't know the years, but I'm guessing that they were in the mid-50s or late 50s, 60s, and I know the school was sold to some of the instructors, and it's since disintegrated. Well, my hour is up. I certainly enjoyed the opportunity to tell you these things, and believe me, if you've learned anything today or heard something you never heard before, tell them you heard it on this channel first. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Ed. I'm sure very few people could tell such an interesting story, and even less could tell it as well as you told it. Did you finish that story yet about the guy that was, I was out of the room for a while, that was listening and heard? DeForest didn't have the nerve to call him?
I don't know that story. Somebody.
You started at the beginning and said, I'll come back to this story later.
I did come back.
Okay, I was out of the room. I'm sorry. I didn't hear that. Well, thank you again, Ed Dervishian, and thanks to everybody.
Hello again on another day. Obviously, when you have only an hour to do things, you leave a few things out. Secondly, on another day, you can think of a few more things to add to the story. Here are a few more about Lee DeForest. Some of his mountain climbing experiences. Lee DeForest used to climb Mount Whitney every year on his birthday, August 26th. However, on the last time he was up there, and I don't know the year, he met a fellow with a bicycle who had carried it up to the top of Mount Whitney to take a photograph of himself and the bicycle next to the sign that said, Mount Whitney, highest point in continental United States. On that particular occasion, Lee DeForest broke a leg coming down, so that was his last trip up Mount Whitney. On other occasions, Lee DeForest would climb just any old mountain. He'd drive his car as far as he could, selecting a particular mountain that looked like a challenge to him, and he'd take a stocking from his wife's collection and put apples and oranges in it and tie it around his waist. That was his lunch. But by tying the stocking around his waist, it left his hands free to grasp other things should he need them. On this particular occasion, he walked around the mountain that he had selected, knowing that he could get back to his car by dusk. Except that there was one little thing he hadn't thought of or noticed or realized was in his path. Just a short distance from the car, he encountered a sheer cliff on one side and a creek on the other. He knew he couldn't go all the way back to his car. It'd be way too dark. He couldn't find his way. It was obvious he couldn't scrape along the side of the cliff, possibly falling into the creek. And that left just one possible way to get back to his car. He took off all his clothes, bundled them up together with his shoes, and tossed them across the creek, waded across the creek naked, dried himself off as best he could, and made it back to the car in time. Lee DeForest's father was a minister. I don't know if you knew that, but he should have been a rather religious person. But as he told the story to me, he lost all of his religion in one day. When he was a college student at Talladega, he prayed and prayed and prayed that he should be named the valedictorian of his class. However, when the occasion arose, the officials named someone else. Lee DeForest was so disappointed and so distraught about religion, he lost it all that night. As he was telling me the story, I said, "But doctor, didn't you realize that maybe the other fellow had prayed longer, more often, and more sincere than you did?" He said, "You know, nobody ever told me that before." Last but not least, Lee DeForest was asked to be the guest on a Today show headed by Dave Garraway. That particular instance, he had been instructed that he would be given a particular list of questions. With these questions, they had also provided the answers. And Lee DeForest said, "You mean I have to answer these questions with your answers?" I said, "Well, yes," he says. "No thanks," and turned it down flatly. Well, there you have it. Hopefully you've enjoyed this little session, and my name is Ed Dervishian. Thank you kindly.